Record to the cloud. Again. Welcome everybody. Good to have you here. It's a much nicer day in here today, than it's been. So I hope that's true at home. So we will welcome. I'm Pastor Barbara at Holy Redeemer Lutheran Church, and we are going to begin with Frederick. And we will sing How Great Is Our God. Welcome to worship. Welcome to you if you are male or female or a little bit of each, queer or straight or a little bit of each, black or brown or white or a little bit of each, old or young or a little bit of each, rich or poor or a little bit of each, doubting or believing or a little bit of each. Welcome to worship. Let us confess and be forgiven. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates us, redeems us, and calls us by name. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you and your beloved children. We have turned our faces away from your glory when it did not appear as we expected. We have rejected your word when it made us confront ourselves. We have failed to show hospitality to those you called us to welcome. Accept our repentance for the things we have done and the things we have left undone. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us and lead us that we may bathe in the glory of your Son born among us and reflect your love for all creation. Amen. Rejoice in this good news. In Christ Jesus, our sins are forgiven. You are descendants of the Most High, adopted into the household of Christ and inheritors of eternal life. Live as freed and forgiven children of God. Amen.
Let us pray. Blessed Lord God, you have caused the Holy Scriptures to be written for the nourishment of your people. Grant that we may hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that comforted by your promises, we may embrace and forever hold fast to the hope of our eternal life. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Scripture reading is from 1 Corinthians. The apostle and pastor Paul uses the metaphor of the human body to describe how intimately connected we are in the church. For this struggling congregation in Corinth, Paul delivers a vital message of unity that is a mark of the church today. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, so it is with Christ. So in the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with great honor, and our less respectable members are treated with great respect, whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, then gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But strive for the greater gifts. The word of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
Okay. So, hi kids. I don't know how many of you are there because I can't really see you all, but do you know what it is to have a custom? Like, for instance, it's a custom in most people's homes, most Christians at least, to have a Christmas tree. Whether there's kids at home or one person, you may have a little tree, you may have a big tree, but it's a custom to always have a tree or to make Christmas cookies or all the various things that are customary for us to do. Well, in the gospel lesson, Jesus, it says Jesus, as was his custom, went to the synagogue. Every week he went to church, and that was his custom. So I think it's something for us to pay attention to, because if anybody knew God and knew God really well, it was Jesus. But he went to church, it was his custom, because He wanted to be with the people of God. He wanted to pray together with others. He wanted to be a part of what God is doing in the world, was doing in the world at his during his day, during his time. So very cool for us to have a custom of coming on Zoom, coming to church in whatever form it is. It's a way for all of us to come together and to know God better and to draw closer to Jesus, because it is Jesus' custom to be with us in worship. Amen. So please arise as you are able for the gospel reading according to Luke chapter 4. Near the beginning of Jesus' public ministry, he visits his hometown of Nazareth. In the words of Isaiah, he states and claims his identity, purpose, and mission. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in the synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." The gospel of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. Today we have the pleasure of hearing a sermon from Pastor Tia. And so be sure and let us know if there are issues with the sound. And hopefully it will all go beautifully. So, all right, I'm going to put this on mute.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Dear saints, dear bodies of Christ, dear body of Christ. Louisa is strong, like really strong. She can lift mountains, she can carry churches and four donkeys at the same time. If anyone needs any help with anything, she'll run and help out. No questions asked, no payment accepted. She knows if she cannot handle something, no one can, which is why she will always handle anything. And Louisa takes pride in her abilities, in her strength, in her endurance. She loves the feeling of being needed. It makes her feel worthy of being loved. Others depend on her and admire her. She really has a purpose in life, and she likes to sing, "I move mountains, I move churches, and I glow because I know that my worth is, and I don't ask how hard the work is, got a rough, indestructible surface." Louisa is tired. The work never seems to end. The needs never seem to decrease. No matter how hard she works, how many hours she puts in, there's always something else or someone else. She would really, really like to take a break. But then who will step up? Who will fill in for her? Right. There's nobody. She just has to keep going. And she sings, "A light wind blows, you try to stop it tumbling, but on and on it goes. But wait, if I could shake the crushing weight of expectations, would that free some room up for joy or relaxation or simple pleasure?" Louisa is afraid. Afraid to show weakness, to let her family and friends, her neighbors and community down. But when she's honest, that's only part of the the strong one. What will people see in her if she stops doing everything all the time? Will they be disappointed? Will they think she's ill and losing her powers? Will they pity her? But worse than all of that are her self-doubts. She sings, "Under the surface, I'm pretty sure I'm worthless if I can't be of service." And so she keeps on going, telling herself she's doing it for the others, while knowing that she doesn't know what to do otherwise. She's stuck, exhausted, afraid, and she loves what she is doing for the people around her. Luisa is caught in a dilemma. And when she finally realizes it, her powers suddenly fade. The worst happens. She doesn't seem to have a purpose anymore. She feels worthless. She desperately tries to hide her weakness. Of course, that doesn't really work. Now, if you have already watched the new Disney movie, Encanto, you have recognized Luisa Madrigal, the strongest, oldest sister among the gifted grandkids. If you haven't watched it yet, watch it. It's an incredible movie and you don't have to be a kid to love it. I promise. The entire story could be watched as a church's struggle trying to be independent and perfect and good and generous in giving to the community while forgetting that they're surrounded by a community that would love to be more than just served or be an admiring audience. Okay, I'll stop here because I don't want to spill the beans, but seriously, watch the movie. Luisa is also the perfect example of a most committed volunteer or church worker. She's the arm of the community, which basically turns her village into a one-armed body of people, symbolically speaking. One person being the one arm in that image of the body of Christ that the Apostle Paul is so passionate about in today's reading. The body of Christ that's made out of many members, and while Paul doesn't specifically name most of the body parts, there are some he names. The feet and hands, the ears and eyes, and the sense of smell, which feels a little bit random, to be honest. Maybe Paul had lost his sense of smell at one point and therefore really values getting it back. This is pure guessing, but I know that some of you can relate and will never take smells for granted again. Now, the idea to symbolize a healthy community as a body that wasn't Paul's. It was a common one among philosophers and people in power. Most often it was actually used to support the social hierarchy, whether of the family or the city or the empire as a whole. And the point was that every body needs a head to live and think and make decisions. In society, that was provided by the wealthy, the rulers, and the elite. Sure, every ideal body also needs hands and feet to do the hard and dirty work. And that was provided in society by just about everyone else. The image worked perfectly to maintain and stabilize a hierarchical society. And Paul, as really seems to be one of his favorite things to do, draws on the same image, as if to say, "Look, I'm speaking your language, I'm one of you." And then he turns the point in the opposite direction. First of all, he claims that no member of the body, no body part, is worth less than any other in its function. And he says, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. Which really is the ultimate argument in a Christian or Jewish context, right? Like, God did it. That was what God wanted. Yet Paul isn't done yet. It gets even niftier. The hierarchy even gets turned on its head. And I quote Paul, "The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again, the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those members of the body that we think less honorable We clothe with greater honor, and our less respectable members are treated with greater respect. Whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. Yes, that's right. Whoever we perceive as weaker or maybe even indispensable, like, sure, you could live with just one foot or one arm, but not without your one head, the more honorable that body part, that member, that person in our community is. Why? Because the head doesn't need to be reminded of its worthiness. Everyone will agree on that, because without the head, the body will die. But the arm might need reassurance that it's worthy, no matter whether it can do the work or not. Because first of all, there are two arms. And secondly, rest is important. Otherwise, the muscles get sore and hurt and maybe even get pulled. That's no fun. Now, if I were to ask you which body part you are in the body of Christ, what would be your answer? Are you a great listener? Or are you good at sharing your stories? Or are you the hands-on person changing the lights and the paraments on the altar? Maybe you're someone walking around making sure that people have food and clothes. Are you the arm carrying tables and chairs for people to relax and to connect? Are you the nose making sure that there are fresh flowers on the altar and that the wine doesn't turn bad? And then once you've answered that question, how are you with that? Is there maybe something else you would like to do or be instead? But you can't do it in addition to all your duties. And of course, you can't stop what you're doing, because who would take over from you? Sounds somewhat familiar. I often feel like there's so many ideas we have, so many things we want to do, so many people we want to reach or connect with or help. And I experience brainstorming what could be possible as life-giving, as energizing, as uplifting, as giving us a purpose for why we're here. It's so much fun to think about hosting an art exhibition with a preschool at church, or envisioning neighborhood gatherings around a shared meal, of dreaming about concerts in our sanctuary, faces start glowing, eyes begin to sparkle. It's almost magical. That is until the real planning begins. The who does what? From feeling like we could move mountains and churches and neighborhoods, the group mode usually changes quickly to looks of exhaustion and tiredness. I mean, who's left to start a new project? Who has the energy and the physical capacity? Who has the time? Everyone is already doing so much, giving so much of their time and talents to their church. And most of you wear many more than one hat in your church. And I know you love it, and it's great. And it's exhausting. But of course we can't admit that openly, because who else would do the work? We don't want to let anybody down or pile another task on someone else's shoulders. So we usually all keep going, afraid that others might have to step away or move away, feeling the burden that comes with less people doing so much. Sometimes it feels just like too much, like our small church body is too old or too small or both. Because we often confuse the body of Christ with our home church. And not that we're not the body of Christ. Of course we are. We're just not the body of Christ in its entirety. In our small churches, it might feel like there's just one arm left, or one hand, or one eye. It might feel like we're giving everything we have, and it's still hardly enough to survive. And then Paul reminds us of the body of Christ, made out of many members, citywide, synodwide, even worldwide. Paul reminds us that no member is worthless, no body part is worthless. To get back to the movie Encanto, Luisa learns the hard way that she doesn't have to do it all by herself. And I wonder what our learning path will look like. After all, Paul says, if one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now, you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. Why? For in the one spirit, we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one spirit. And remember, we are fed with the body of Christ to be the body of Christ here in Tri-City with many hands and feet and arms and eyes. And I'm noticing that I'm getting excited about the mere possibilities, the dreams that could be not just dreamt, but followed through. The joy to help each other carry the load and enjoy the meal at the tables we all carried out. One day, God willing. Amen.
Please join me as we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please join me in the prayers of the church. God of grace, hear our prayer. Yes, the Spirit of the Lord is poured out upon us in abundance. So we are bold to pray for the church, the world, and all that God has made. You reveal yourself to us in the reading of Scripture. Fulfill your word through the faithful witness of your church. Send us out to bring your liberating good news to all people. God of grace, hear our prayer. All creation proclaims your handiwork. Teach us to love the intricate and beautiful bodies that you have created. Bless tiny insects, enormous whales, and every creature in between. Sustain species at risk of extinction. God of grace, hear our prayer. You desire that there be no dissension among us, where we are divided in our society, nation, or world. Come quickly to reunite us into one body. Ease conflict, dispel violence, and bring an end to war. God of grace, hear our prayer. Anoint with your spirit all who seek your favor. Grant provision and justice for people living in poverty, people living with disability, those living with pain, or those living under oppression. God of grace, hear our prayer. Build up the body of Christ in this place. Bless the variety of ministries in this congregation. Empower us to freely welcome and deeply value each person who enters into worship and ministry among us. God of grace, hear our prayer. In thanksgiving, we lift you before the saints, for whom the promise of salvation has now been fulfilled. Tend to those who mourn. Bring us together in your everlasting glory. God of grace, hear our prayer. Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all our prayers to you in confidence and faith. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Okay, now we'll all join together in communion. As Frederick plays, eat this bread. Please gather a little bit of wine and a little bit of bread, and we'll all come together. Please rise as you are able. By your powerful word, you created all things. Through the prophets, you called your people to be a light to the nations. Blessed are you for Jesus, your Son. He is your light, shining in our darkness and revealing to us your mercy and might. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his preaching and healing, his dying and rising, and his promise to come again, we await that day when all the universe will rejoice in your holy and life-giving light. By your Spirit, bless us and this meal, that refreshed with this heavenly food, we may be light for the world, revealing the brilliance of your Son. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen.
Please join me in praying with the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Let's see. Taste and see that the Lord is good. This is the body of Christ given for you. Amen. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Amen.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, gracious God, for we have feasted on the abundance of your house. Send us to bring good news and to proclaim your favor to all. Strengthened with the richness of your grace, in your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
receive the blessing. The God of hope, fill us with all joy and peace in believing, so that all may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit, through Christ Jesus, the Word made flesh. Amen.
To a weary world, share the good news. Thanks be to God.
All right.